Welcome to the video from the beautiful San Francisco South Bay area. I'm Clarity Ross, and my pronouns are 000. Yeah, and the beer that I drink is coconut water. And my past is wow, my present is wow, my future is wow. Great. And the times are so shocking that we're losing our dread, I think, you know. Yeah. Golly. But it's not that bad because we're focused on singularity. So why do I say that my pronouns are 000? Because I'm a zero-dimensional being, as are you. As is everyone, actually. And even, I would say, always everywhere, never from anywhere. Zero dimensional being, wow. Always everywhere, never from anywhere. Zero dimensional being, wow. So we covered all the bases here. We're completely woke, right? We're completely woke is our natural condition. We're woke to our zero dimensionality. Meaning that we're always everywhere, never from anywhere. Never from anywhere. That's called zero dimensionality. That's what we actually are. Total perfection, ing, perfect freedoming. I am light, I am light, I am light. Wow. So, focusing on singularity. The reality is just a singularity. It's a singularity. That's all it is. So just singularly focused on singularity ing wow. Just singularly focused on singularity ing wow. You know, if you're a boomer 65 or over, you're probably watching this video. Everybody else is welcome as well. As we really focus on singularity, that's what I've been doing to date. Not easy. I've been making so much progress. I'm now into just this singularity, but kind of like it's a slightly rarefied atmosphere, you might say, which is good, but kind of got to be patient because we're not so used to just this. Avatar Ananamaima is really good at getting to the singularity. She'll toss out some bones here, you know, chew on this, and then she'll, but really, this is what it's at. And then she'll speak in a total singularity way, which I love. I love that. Wow. And, you know, you can just feel that you love it. You don't know why you love it. Well, you love it because it's reality. And we are trying to convince singularity that its future is one of limitation, ruination, fragmentation, impermanence. We're trying to convince singularity that it's not really singularity, which is impossible. So when we try, you know, we're addicted to trying to do the impossible. So it's not so easy to focus on singularity, that's for sure. But we can feel like there's something that attracts us to us, but it still seems very kind of odd and vague and distant, not sure. But right here, it's starting to get dialed in more. It doesn't mean that it's still easy. It's getting easier, and I have hit some high points, and then it kind of like backslide a little bit, but that's to be expected. So the same thing with you. You'll notice that you make some progress. You hit your high notes, and then you'll slide back down. Can't hit too many high notes because then you'll like get tired. It's kind of like trying to sing like the Beach Boys, which I was doing today, harmonizing with the Beach Boys, which is really quite a very extreme exercise, you might say. Listening to like 50 greatest hits and then trying to fit in different parts and all this stuff. And yeah, they really give you an exercise because the vocal range there is just all over the charts. It's just crazy. And, after a while, like the highest stuff just kind of goes, you can't really keep it going forever. It's, they had naturally high voices. Brian Wilson and Carl Wilson certainly did. Brian's was like naturally contra alto, and Carl's was alto tenor for sure. Was way up there too, but not easy. Do it sitting, getting out of bed, I can do it, but then after a while, kind of collapses. So it's kind of like going after singularity. Is you can get some high points there, and you really, and then kind of like that, you start losing. So that's okay. But we're in the ballpark, very much in the ballpark here, very, very, very much in the ballpark. I really am feeling the avatar right now, because she's able to convey it in different ways than previously, kind of. It just has a knack for that. And so we're just calling on her to help us out at this point. And I don't want to say, overstate it. It's just, it's so difficult and awkward to talk about or to point to if you don't have the right context. And so our context is all important in here, and we say, why are we having troubles? Because we had this idea of trying to be prior to the prime creator, as if we were the prime creator. We can't experience this. We blame the lack of experiencing on the prime creator and claim the prime creator is defective. It's blocking us. It's against us. And then we felt we needed to get rid of the prime creator. So we've been trying to figure out a way to do this, and it's impossible, but we feel we have to figure out a way to do it. And so that's the basic, and we're terrified if we stop doing it, we won't know how to function at all. So the remedy, what's the remedy for this? It's pretty simple, but not, not so easy to talk about because it hasn't been talked about before. So the remedy is really the Holy Spirit. And I know that the great spiritual coaches in the past say, well, this world, this imperfect world, you'll never can be never be happy with this imperfect world. Not quite true. Not quite true. Even the Avatar said that. But she's building up to, to a singularity. But here we have some additional information given to us by Jesus, and I've been working. Affiliated with Jesus, working for a long time to clarify, how do we really get saved from our misery of clinging to really trying to accomplish an impossible task is what it really is. What this universe is just a tool. This universe is just a tool. The universe, this world, our consciousness, our bodies are just tools we're using to try and accomplish the impossible, which is to get the prime creator to self-destruct. And so it's just miserable for us. We're so insecure. And we think, how do we get back to functioning in reality? I don't know if we can even do it. Well, we know that this attempt to do the impossible is inherently frustrating, confusing, full of projection and blame. And it intrinsically highlights build up and tear down, impermanence, etc. is horrible. And so we think, well, how could we get used to perfection? This universe doesn't showcase perfection at all. Well, there's a very interesting way around this trouble that we have, and that is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit can showcase perfection within the context of imagination. It's a unique capability that the Holy Spirit was created for. And we say, well, wait a minute. That contradicts the Avatar, what you said? Not exactly. Not exactly. And so we're going to explain that a little bit here in the video. Look at this, maybe for the first time anyone's ever looked at this. So what I'm saying is the Holy Spirit is able to give us, simulate this perfection, like the perfection of reality, perfection within time, within the belief in time, the belief in impermanence, the belief in imperfection, etc. But here's the key to it. It's able to do that, but only temporarily, not permanently. How about that? So this is an amazing insight that came about today. Terrific, terrific, all-time great insight. It's able to do it. It's able to simulate perfection for us so that we can get used to perfectioning so that then we can lose our fear of functioning in reality. The only difference is in reality, perfectioning is permanent. It's always this way, whereas as the Holy Spirit's perfectioning within the context of our scheme, it's temporary. It's not permanent. Okay, so that's the beginning of our clarification here in this video. We will continue on. So how does that help us? Well, the Holy Spirit's able to keep this simulation of perfectioning until every single one of us have gained confidence that we can function in reality. Okay, and then the Holy Spirit says, oh, well, it's not needed anymore. Therefore, I can drop the perfectioning and also drop the backloaded imperfectioning. It's backloaded with imperfectioning. So the Holy Spirit's perfectioning is backloaded with imperfectioning, except it holds that backloading part off until all of us have been liberated, all aspects of spirit have been liberated, and then it says, you know what? I don't even need this perfectioning at all. So I don't need the backloaded imperfection. The whole thing is just, I can just drop it right now, no more. How about that? So that's the key to it. It's impermanent, and the Holy Spirit knows it's impermanent, but it can keep it in place for us until every one of us says, "You know what? I don't need that anymore. I don't need it. I'm confident I can function in reality. So I don't even need a simulation of perfection." So this is the way the Holy Spirit gets around this issue. It's perfection, but not permanent perfection. How about that? Wow. So this really tilts things completely in our favor right now in the world. The mail has been delivered. Speaking of that, maybe they'll start saying the female has been delivered. Wait, you can't say the male has been delivered, you know? speaking of that, the Holy Spirit, reality doesn't have any mothering to it at all. There's just a singularity. It's just perfection, this absolute perfect freedoming, perfectioning. It's all just exactly the same, always everywhere, never from anywhere. It's this singularity. When you experience it, you'll understand. There's no mothering to that at all. There's no mothering to that whatsoever. You can't even say there's a fathering to it either. So really, the path of liberation from our paranoia that we won't be able to function if we stop pretending limitation, ruination. It starts out as we want our path to be mothered. We want it to be mothered because that's when we feel most frightened and fearful and helpless and independent. We always turn to mother, 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 mother. But as we start gaining momentum towards truth and having experiences, then we say, hey, you know, I don't think that reality is really being mothered by anything. There's nothing prior to reality to mother it. Reality is not something that's been born out of something else. No, it's intrinsic. So we turn to fathering. And the fathering gives us a little more adamant talk and more disciplined adamant talks. Is, you know, this is the way it is and it's not any other way. So you get this wonderful kind of fathering influence. Course in Miracles is like that. It's like a fathering influence. It's very adamant and uncompromising. And ultimately, then you go even beyond that, and then you just get Holy Spirit acceptancing. You start accepting the grace, salvation by grace. So not even any mothering, no fathering, just gracing. And that ultimately leads to recognizing how the Holy Spirit easily liberates us from our real problem, which is that we're paranoid, that if we stop pretending, we won't know how to function. That's the problem we actually have that is causing us to keep clinging to these tools that we're using to try to trick the prime creator into self-destruction, which is this universe, consciousness, this world, bodies, nature, form, all the stuff. These are just tools that spirit's using to try and so-called enlighten the prime creator that its future is really one of limitation and ruination. It has no choice but to experience these. Whereas the Holy Spirit will say to us, well, your future in this dream of trying to trick the prime creator into believing that it has a future limitation or nation, your future is that way, actually. But right now, you can feel perfect right now, but your future is going to be one of limitation, ruination, tragedy, but not right now. And the Holy Spirit that can keep backing off that future until you experience this present perfectioning, until you say, hey, you know what? I feel super confident I can function in reality. And so I don't even need this imaginary perfectioning, you might say. Don't even need it. And so I also don't need the fact that it's backloaded. So once it's gone, the backloaded part cannot affect you. You're no longer involved with the whole situation, that situation at all. So we can experience perfection right now. And yes, it's only temporary. But we will get to the point where we say we don't even need time at all. Once we accept we don't need time at all, we can accept reality, we will not be subject to experiencing anything at all that can happen in time, including imperfection and limitation. So super, super great way to be liberated from delusion. It's the Holy Spirit. So the path, starts out as mother worshippers, goddess worshippers, such and such and such. Those are beginners. And then you get into father worshippers, and those are intermediates. And then you get into really Holy Spirit acceptancing, and that's advanced, very advanced. So that's what we're at right now. This is what we're really, really, really moving into, this Holy Spirit acceptance of how Holy Spirit can easily all be liberated from misery. We'll experience perfectioning right now with realizing it's only temporary. However, again, we don't need it to be everlasting, imaginary perfection to be everlasting, because it will solve our confidence problem, and when we can accept what truly is everlasting perfectioning, which is reality, we won't have any fear that we won't be able to function. We'll say, oh, I'm positive I can function in that perfectioning, no problem. Don't need time anymore. Don't need imaginary perfection backloaded with limitation, ruination. Don't need it anymore. So this is something that, again, I've never heard anyone talk about this. Because most people are beginners or intermediate. They're either caught up in mother worshiping or father worshiping. And they're still struggling, trying to figure out, how can I make this work? How can I make this work? But whereas the real problem is, again, we believe that we won't know how to function in reality if we stop pretending limitation, ruination. That's the problem that actually is causing all our fear. It's not fear of God attacking us or any of that kind of stuff. That's earlier teachings. And once you mature past those teachings, then you'll say, okay, so God's not angry with us. Everything's, no problem, etc. Great. But you still feel some fear, and you say, what's going on? I thought I got it. I thought I figured it all out. No. It's simply familiarity with pretending. Familiarity with pretending that we're subject to limitation, ruination. That's the problem, is our habit, our familiarity. And we're so used to it, we can't even imagine functioning any other way. We cannot even imagine it. So we have to really experience this present perfectioning within this context of imagining limitation, ruination. It's kind of like we say, well, we feel this like, vast spaciousness, never-ending vast spaciousness. And we say, well, it does come to an end. It's just so far away that I can't even imagine how far away it is. Therefore, it feels endless. You see, this is what we're getting at. It's an illusion of endlessness. The Holy Spirit will say, well, yeah, I mean, ultimately, it does come to an end, but it's so far off, you know, that like this perfection will come to an end, but it's like, you know, godzillion years in the future. And so then you say, God, you know, it's just really, I can't even imagine that. So therefore, it doesn't affect me so much. But ultimately, we gain confidence. And then we say, even we don't even need this, you know, trouble, godzillion years in the future. We don't even need any time at all. Don't need any placing at all, that kind of thing. So yeah, the Holy Spirit can do that. But if we're trying to solve it ourselves, we'll say, no, I want the impermanence right now. I want the troubles right now so I can work on those troubles right now. I don't want them delayed, you know, trillions and trillions and trillions of years in the future, and then I have to deal with them. That's stupid. You can't gain confidence that you can function in reality if you're struggling with the troubles of impermanence. So have it delayed. Just accept like extreme delay. Extreme time-space-based delay, extreme delay as far as, you know, working on this, trying to convince the Prime Creator to self-destruct, you know, the pain and suffering of that we have to act out. Let's just say I'm going to delay that, really extreme delay. And then we'll get used to a feeling of like near perfection, so very, very close to perfection. As far as imagination goes, it seems perfect, yeah. So we're digging into this variable here with the Holy Spirit, we're really digging into it. And it's you know, a little awkward, getting better every day at looking at this, because it just hasn't been done. It just hasn't been done. But, you know, if you listen to this, you realize, wow, you know, it seems like there's a shortcut, a great shortcut. By making time and place seem like it's almost perfect, and it's so almost perfect that the distancing in time and space seems so distant, the trouble seems so distant that we cannot remotely even think about it, really, or imagine it in any way. And so our feeling is perfect now, and then this gets us acquainted with perfectioning, and we'll realize we can function within perfectioning. So it's like, So I'm working on this, getting it dialed in more and more and more. Every day it seems to be more clarification on this. So it's a great thing to have right now, that we're able to directly look at the Holy Spirit and focus on what it can do to help us, rather than trying to get help from the goddesses and the gods and goddesses and goddess worshiping and God worshiping. We've been there, done that. It just doesn't seem to work. It doesn't work. And we don't have any time anymore for what doesn't work. You know, that's just it. It's just, you know, our pronouns are 000. You know, we need just always, everywhere, never from anywhere. Zero-dimensional being, wow, I am zero. I am zero, I am zero, I am zero. Wow. Yeah, I was watching this bureaucratic roundtable of all these, you know, student politician types with the, I think it was the vice president was presiding over a group. I think it was mostly women, might have been all women, student politicians, we call them. And they're introducing themselves and everyone's laughing. You know, it's a nice hen party going on. And they say, hello, I'm, you know, so-and-so. And my pronouns are she, did. I don't know what they're talking about when they say their pronouns. They give some pronouns out. I say, what? So everybody introduces themselves by telling everybody what my pronouns are. Everyone goes, oh, wonderful, that's so great, yeah, wow. We're so happy that we're making such incredible progress here, you know. So I guess you have to introduce yourself, tell everybody, well, there's my pronouns, whatever that means. I have no idea what it means. But I do know what 000 means, because that's our true identity. So why not introduce yourself as your true identity? Why introduce yourself as a dream character? You say, hello, my dream character's pronouns are, you know. Well, who cares what your dream character's pronouns are? You know, shouldn't we be focused on what our true pronouns are, which is 000? Just that, 000. So if we understand the Holy Spirit, all these spiritual arguments in the past are just gone. Just gone. Because they can't figure it out. No matter what they do with God, goddess and God worshiping, it doesn't seem to work. And so they have to kind of explain, why they doesn't, it gets just really complicated. They say, well, it's like, does this sound right? And maybe this is, and it's never right. It's never right. But when you see just the simplicity of what we're talking about, the Holy Spirit has a unique capability within the realm of imagination, our pretending. It has total mastery of it right now, and it uses its mastery of this to backload it in an extreme way. And it knows what it's backloading, and also the Holy Spirit never identifies with it and never gets addicted to this. So it can drop it. When it needs to drop it, it's going to drop it like that. Whereas if we try to do this, we get totally addicted to it and be too paranoid to drop it. The Holy Spirit has zero paranoia in dropping this. It's only going to keep going until no one needs it. At that point, it's going to drop this scheme, completely drop it. So it keeps the scheme of limitation and ruination. It just says we're gonna like super backload it. So we're gonna feel like perfect right now, but backloaded with this imperfection and ruination. But it's like really, really, really in the distance and time and space, extremely so, right? And it'll remain extremely so. Like that. So, but it's not going to get rid of our scheme for us. So we feel like we still have the scheme. It's just now the ratio of backloading, and like the build-up teardown thing has been changed, where it's just kind of like all stable, super stability, you might say. Just a super stability. We'll just feel this kind of super stability, where it's kind of like the first thing that we're going to use is like spaciousness. As far as form goes, and we're gonna, and so somewhere really distant in time and space, there's going to be some alteration, some limitation put on spaciousness, but we haven't reached that yet, so to speak. It's something like that the Holy Spirit does. So we'll feel this present perfection everywhere, equally everywhere. But it's not entirely permanent. It's not entirely permanent. Okay, we admit to that. It's not entirely permanent. So it's we're trying to dial this in is what we're doing. I'm here like on the radio, and it's kind of like trying to dial it in so I get a clear signal to it. I'm really, really feeling that the song is there. Yeah, the hummingbird's back, and I gave it some sugar water. And it's drinking right now. Hey, you happy? Yeah. Good. I don't even think the ants have come back yet. That's great. Wow, hummingbird's taking a big old drink of this stuff. That's a good sign, right? Good sign. Drinking deeply of this. So this is just something brand new that has just come to light. Wow. And it feels extremely auspicious, but not always easy to stay with it. You know, it isn't. I get tired. There's a lot of psychological resistance. It's just because it's unfamiliar doesn't mean it's wrong. So we always have a bias against what's unfamiliar, no matter what. Even if it could be like the greatest thing ever, we'll still have a bias against it. So you have to be very humble. And this make-believe scenario of limitation and ruination, this scheme to try to convince the prime creator to self-destruct, it's really good, helpful to be humble. It's super important to be humble. Humility means you feel like you don't know it all. You don't know the answer yet. Okay, you don't know the answer yet. That's humility. Because 100% minus in this world don't know the answer yet. In fact, they're not even remotely clued, dialed into it. Not even remotely dialed. Not even thinking about dialing it at all. So, we have to be super humble here. Have to be super humble. To be super humble, it really helps. Some people are still drinking. To be big time by someone. So someone's just so big time that you don't even think about anything other than humility. It's like playing golf with Tiger Woods, essentially. Like, that would be being big timed. You want to be big timed. So that's an excuse to be humble. You don't want to try to compete with everybody. You don't want a situation where you think, gee, I'm almost as good as them. I almost know everything that they know. And so, we're all the same. That's horrible. People say we're all the same. Not in this dream of limitation ruination, we're not. We're all different in our pretending. We all have different roles, and we all have different levels of addiction to pretending. And mostly it's all severe paranoia, severe paranoia. We wouldn't even be here in this world without severe paranoia. So we need someone that doesn't have any paranoia at all. And then, so they're way in vastly more advantageous position than we are. They're vastly more skilled, better off than we are. So they're big time. So when you come into contact with someone who's really big time, you feel like you've been big timed. You know, it's like, wow, I just need to be humble here. Yeah, there's nothing else I can do. So fortunately, I've had many such situations, fortunate enough to have experienced that. And you just realize, wow, I'm not in their class at all, not even remotely in their class. So I just better shut up and listen. And, it's kind of like a boss. The boss tells you something. Say, boss, I want you here, such and such, 8 o'clock. Okay, I'm there at 8 o'clock. I don't ask questions. Say, I want you here, I'm there. Okay, this is what I want you to do, you do it. Okay, this is the next thing to do, you do it. That's right. It's like a boss. These days, the younger generation, they want to kind of do away with that. Let's just do kind of a collective thing. No. Because if you have 100 people that are suffering from extreme paranoia, they're going to come up with an extremely paranoid solution that doesn't work. When they let's just get a consensus going here, as if consensus is somehow going to solve the problem. So they're afraid of being big timed. I love it when someone's just so much better. I say, gee, I'm going to just, pay attention to what they're doing and see what I can learn and how this helps me, etc. It takes the pressure off of you. It takes the pressure. You're not expected to know everything. And, especially right now in the world, it seems like nobody, everyone's clueless as to what the true remedy is. They don't even know what the problem is. They don't even realize they have a problem. It's just incredible. So under such a circumstances, you want to be big timed. So I play golf with Tiger Woods. You just, whatever you say, Tiger. Yeah, okay, whatever you say. Me, I'm not even saying anything about my game. I'm just out there and listening to what he says, the advice he has to give, how to conduct yourself, and just soaking it up. I'm not out there saying, hey, Tiger, you think you can take me? Really? I don't think so. Let's see. Forget that. Let's listen and just experience it. Imagine that, playing around a golf with Tiger Woods. You just experience the incredible confidence and competence. And just how it just, you realize it's possible. It's possible to be like this. He's experiencing the golf course in a totally different way. Totally different way than I am. I'm just saying, I just hope I just don't die out here. And he's just thinking completely different. I'm just gonna take this golf course apart. It's like, how am I gonna take it apart today? It's so completely different mentality, mindset, focus, and there. So you can experience that. The confidence. It's confidence. His confidence on a golf course. I've had the good fortune of walking along in his gallery and watching Tiger play live and work, practicing before a round and getting ready and everything. He just exudes this calm, undisturbed confidence. And I'm saying, dude, how can you possibly feel this that way when you're facing this monster golf course? Isn't that a monster golf course for him? He's just saying, I got 100 different ways to take this course apart, And I'm going to have a lot of fun doing it. I just want to make sure I'm rolling in these 10-footers every single time. Oh, there you go. There's another one. Okay. Got it. Feeling good today. And it's just joking. It's calm. And first tee. And backswing hits a stinger down there, you know, 300 right in the middle. And it's like, okay, here we go. What? So that's big, being big time. You want to be. I love being big time. You know, that's just like the best thing ever. It's the best thing ever. And so if you have that attitude, then you got to realize you're in good shape. That means you really are dialed in, starting to dial it in. Whereas if you just say, I don't want any bosses. I don't want anyone telling me what to do. I don't want anyone better than me. We're all equal. That's super immaturity. It means you're not even going in the right direction at all. So all this like fanatical push for equality of results, equality of position, equality of this, you know, this shows just an extreme paranoia. Everyone's terrified of being big time. I don't want to get on a golf course with anyone who plays better than me. That make me feel insecure. I feel uncomfortable. That's like really bigoted or something. I don't know. It's got to be something like that. As if that's the reason why I don't feel comfortable on a golf course, because somebody else is playing better than me. If everyone just played exactly the same, I wouldn't even know that how bad I'm playing. You know. So this is normal. Everyone plays this way. You know. They're playing terrible. In other words, I'm playing, you know, total paranoia. I'm in total paranoia. But if everyone's totally paranoid, then everything's, you know, I don't even know I'm paranoid. Well, you may not know it, but you still are, right? Fear's still there. Just because people don't admit to it doesn't mean that it's not there. So, you know, that's just the losing path. That's the path of just continual clinging to misery. So you want to see someone, Buddha Longchenpa, introducing himself to me in a dream. Oh my gosh, you know, he's just exuding calm confidence. Like the world doesn't faze him at all. Totally unfazed. Not say, oh, I'm in the world now. I'm here to help the world. What do? You know, this world's a scary place, difficult. No, nothing like that. So I'm like, wow, it's possible to just feel this way, even though you're here to help out, and you're not fazed in the slightest bit. This is birdie time, man. Come on. There's no problem. So I was kind of asking, any problems, you know? No. How was your walk across the ocean? Warm water's warm, or is it cool? It's both warm and cool. Yeah. In other words, the duality doesn't faze me in the slightest bit. It's all equal to me. It's all equal. Equally untrue. So that's, you know, that's being big time. When someone's just, you realize that they're in a situation where you are just freaked out and they're seeing it completely differently. Like it's not the slightest bit of difficulty at all. I love this. Yeah, no problems at all. Thank you for showing me it's possible. See, thank you for showing me it's possible. Wow. So I'm, you know, trying to get my tiger on on the golf course, so to speak. Still working at it. Got a swing going right now, which is really good and powerful. That's the thing. I had a swing going, which is very accurate. But then I realized you still got to have the power out there. You got to power it out there. And I said, I feel like it's a little short. I'm not just hammering it, which you kind of need to do on some courses. If you want to play at any yardage length, like or over 6,000 yards, you got to hammer the ball off the tee. So now I have a swing that I'm hammering it. I was working out today with a weighted club, and I was swinging that fast. Then I took the regular club. Oh my God, the swing was so fast. So I'm just going to work out with the weighted club and just keep building up my strength with this stance I have. It's great. I know I'm going to be able to hammer the ball. And you need to do that sometimes. Not all the time, but sometimes. Sometimes you finesse it. Sometimes you got to hammer it. And so have both finesse and have a stance for finesse, a stance for hammering it. That's what you want. That's what you want. So I'm real close to that. Really, really, really close to having that. So I just have to be a little patient. And we're really, really close to understand, to recognizing how the Holy Spirit, this hummingbird's still here, is just having a feast. We're real close to recognizing and accepting how the Holy Spirit can liberate us right here, right now. And we need to be liberated right here, right now. Because the ruination in part of this world, the backloaded ruination thing, is really kicking in so strongly. It's so scary that the normalization now, as I've been saying, they're normalizing destruction. They're normalizing it. Someone, in the media corps, they call it, some publication. I won't name the publication or anything like that, but you know, a mainstream leftist publication published an obituary for one of the Supreme Court justices, who's very much alive and living on the Supreme Court, published an imaginary obituary that something had happened to them and they're now dead. And then explaining, you know, why that's not such a big deal and actually, you know, you should have recognized your mistakes while you're still alive. And of course, this was called out by the more conservative media saying this is just absolutely atrocious. This is a line that you can never cross in culture and in civilization. And whereas the left, especially, of course, they won't say a word about it, and probably absolutely nothing will happen. No firing, no suspension. Someone doing that, nothing happens to them. It's unbelievable the double standards going on right now, because these people are tear-down people, ruination people. It's a build-up, tear-down scheme we have. It's a build-up, tear-down scheme we have. So we're in a tear-down phase. We're in a phase of ruination. Ruination. We're trying to enlighten the Prime Creator as this is your future. You see, it seems great, but it doesn't last. The good stuff doesn't last. And we keep showcasing this. The good stuff doesn't last. In order to showcase that the good stuff doesn't last, you have to first build up the good stuff and then bring it to ruination. And so we're trying to tell the Prime Creator, hey, you're perfectioning the eternal, you know, your eternal perfect nowing, or your perfect eternal nowing. It's great. It's great. We agree. It's the best. It's fantastic, but it won't last. It won't last. It'll get torn down and into ruination. And so this is what we're trying to convey to the Prime Creator, is saying, hey, yeah, you know, we've had this really amazing security and all this stuff, but it doesn't last. It falls apart into criminality. And so you get what we have now, where you get the criminal justice system being destroyed by, you know, Soros-backed money, puts these prosecutors, funds these prosecutors somehow, sees that they, you know, get put in place in these cities. And they basically, you know, if you know, they just, it's unbelievable what happens. It's just a breakdown of law and order. It's just extreme corruption. You have now prosecutors just quitting, saying, you know, the district attorney, you know, is just totally corrupt, refuses to prosecute criminals, and they just, you know, it's like they're aiding and abetting criminals. And for those of us who've built up, part of building up law and order, which is civilization, this is just like a complete freak out, you know, total freak out, like it's unthinkable, completely unthinkable, but it's happening. Why? Build up, tear down scheme. So, you know, we've been part of building up something great, and now they're part of tearing down something great. But all this is aimed at the Prime Creator, saying, hey, Prime Creator, we understand that you built up this perfection, this wonderful, eternal, perfect nowing. You built that up. It was a tough job. You built it up, but a great job. But you know what? It's not going to last. It's going to get torn down. And you might as well wake up to that fact. You're in denial. You're in ignorance of this fact. We're just helping you realize what reality is really about. But the truth is, the Prime Creator did not build up this perfection, this eternal perfect knowing, didn't build it up. It's intrinsically that. It's always intrinsically that. It has nothing to do with growth or building up or anything like that. Evolution or nothing. Nothing to do with that. And there's no teardown to it either. None. But yet we're still hooked in this stupid. I mean, the Chinese could blockade, put a naval blockade on Taiwan. That is possible. They're doing exercises right now simulating a naval and aerial blockade of the island. Well, guess what? All the microchips, which they supply most of the world's advanced microchips for all the technology that you know, that's essential technology around the world. If China blockaded Taiwan, that would cause an extreme global economic depression. It would. And it might be cause a spell, like cause for war if they did that. And they're simulating that blockade right now because of the Speaker of the House's very quixotic adventure of going to Taiwan right at this point to cement her legacy without really, against all the counsel, that this is not a wise thing to do right at this point. Gives them an excuse, you know, excuse to... See, so what the U.S. is trying to... They are working on getting the manufacturing of these chips into the United States. They're working on plants. I think I know in Texas they're working on some of their various chip plants. But they're not ready yet. It's going to take a couple years to get them ready. But we're like super over-reliant on Taiwanese microchips. Incredibly over-reliant upon them. The whole world is. So China could just shut the whole world off from commerce. You know, it would just... to be just ruinous if they did that. So we're still a couple years out from doing that. So you might want to not antagonize the Chinese until we get our chip capability online, you know, up and running here in the United States and other places of the world, maybe. So we've diversified away from Taiwan. But that's, you know, that it, just, I guess some people can't quite. Hello, you thanking me for your sugar water? Okay. Hi, buddy. But he's just so happy. He says, thank you so much. He said, thank you so much for all the sugar water you just gave me. Wow. Because it came begging a day or two ago. And because it was all dry, empty. Now it's saying, thanks. I love it. Thank you so much. So, you know, this is geopolitics. And you need to understand what's going on. Apparently, the Speaker of the House had other ambitions. And may have instigated something, you know, really terrible. Certainly flirted with it disastrously. Wow. So again, the world's so unstable that the whole teardown situation, one thing, it could be anything. This could be it. This could be something that just tilts the whole world, just go crazy. Someone who's just not on the ball, you might say, not on the ball at all, thinking of their own grandiosity instead of, you know, what's the big picture here, really? What's the big picture here? I mean, the global depression would hurt China too severely. So that'd be a pretty stupid thing to do. But on the other hand, it could be their opportunity to take over the world. So the long term, they would then have just massive prosperity. So the question is, are the Chinese willing to risk a short-term depression for massive future prosperity? And the problem is the Chinese, they think long-term, like 100 years, 50 years, long-term projects. So they may just say, hey, you know what? Let's have an extreme global depression, just cause massive suffering and turmoil. But the bright side of that is we'll come out of that as dominating the whole entire world, and then we'll have access to all the resources and markets, and we'll just, you know, we'll be in control of all the markets entirely, and so we'll just have unlimited prosperity forever, is how they might look at it. So if you look at it that way, they may just decide to go ahead and get it going, you know. That's the way they think. Is long term. They're willing to have their people suffer in order to gain some huge advantage. Just like the COVID lockdowns that they did over there. So draconian, right? You know, zero cases, that type of thing. They wanted to do that and take a short term hit on their economy, which they're dealing with now, with the benefit of a long-term dominance. They're after long-term dominance. So they're not really worried about paying a price now. It's long-term dominance that they're after. So they may do something that, you know, seems like, wow, this could hurt them too. They could be hurt too. Well, yeah. But it may be worth the price. Maybe worth the price. And so we need to, for sure, have our eye on singularity. This is our true nature. And it's all just one. You hear the teachers, great coaches saying, spiritual coaches saying, it's all one. It's just all one. They say, really? I just have to keep saying this. You don't understand it, but it's true. It's just all one. It is all one. It is always everywhere, never from anywhere. 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 Reality is just all this, just one. It's just one entirety. There's no parts to it. There's no fragments to it. There could be facets to the oneness, but it's all still just one diamond. It's like one diamond with many facets, and yet it's always just one diamond. It's not two diamonds glued together or anything like that. It's all just one. This is total oneness, this is the singularity, I would put it. Just this total singularity. This total singularity. There's nothing other than that. Nothing other than that. So this is reality. And so this is what we have to function as that, in that, as that. So we have to get used to singularity. So, you know, as the potentials for just, you know, really trouble in the world is just escalating, you know, we're looking at, you know, what's the best remedy we have here. And we have this now, this Holy Spirit remedy, which... it's kind of like, let's say, weather. Let's say we have like the South Bay weather, which is just fantastic these days. It's just perfect. It's just incredibly perfect every day. Another incredibly wonderful, perfect day today. So let's just say you have this weather that's just like super, 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 super great. Because let's say the Earth is tilted, your Earth is tilted a certain way, and the tilt out of that is extremely slow. So let's say you're going to be experiencing like perfect weather every day for the next trillion years. Well, you know what? You're going to get really used to that good weather, aren't you? And you're going to say, you know what? I feel I could experience this perfect weather forever. It won't scare me. And at that point, then we don't even need this illusion of perfect weather anymore. We can actually then accept the perfection of the singularity, which is perfect weather forever, so to speak. Whereas in the illusion of perfect weather, the tilt is so slow of the world you're on, so to speak, that again, it's like in a trillion years, this perfect weather will turn into kind of a winterish condition. Not so good. Not so good, kind of bad weather. But that's, you know, that's so far in the future. The tilt is so slow. Meanwhile, you're getting every single moment is this ideally perfect weather. So you'll get used to that. And then you say, hey, you know what? I don't have a problem. I'm not afraid of just having this forever. It doesn't scare me at all anymore. So that's a really good analogy right there. Really good analogy, the Holy Spirit, how the Holy Spirit helps us. Super helpful right there. And thanks to California for giving us this ideal weather. But we know this planet is tilting, unfortunately, such that the sun will seem to go south, and then it'll get colder in the northern hemisphere, and then autumn will come, and then the winter will come. And the summer is gone. So keep an eye on summer this time, this year. Keep on summer, keep an eye on summer this year. That's an analogy, okay? So you're living on a planet, and the tilt on its axis from the tilt from northern hemisphere, southern hemisphere, whatever, is such that you're in this summertime. It just feels ideal. There's a, you know, this coolness of the temperature is just like 82 every day. It's just so nice and perfect. And that lasts, going to last a trillion years. But after that trillion years, the tilt will bring it into wintertime, and it'll enter a time of maybe a trillion years of winter, okay? But we'll be long gone since then. We will realize we can handle perfection, never-ending perfection, without any problem. We'll regain our confidence as we experience every single day being ideal. So that really puts it into sort of an empirical, physical kind of context of an example that we can relate to. But I tell you, here, like you have like a summer like this, I can't imagine going into winter. And once you get used to this weather and you realize, hey, I can function just fine with this perfection. And I got no problem with that. I got no problem with everything being perfect. Not at all. Then this changes your expectations, you see, and then you're ripe for experiencing reality. And you'll say, oh, yeah, not a problem, not a problem. So we do have this. We do so like the Holy Spirit will like produce some sort of psychological weather for us, okay? And it'll this perfect ideal psychological weather is going to last trillions of years for us, but eventually it's going to go into suffering kind of weather, lousy weather we don't like. But we'll be long gone before then in terms of deciding, you know what? I'm willing to have this perfect psychological weather forever. Forever, and then you'll be willing to function in reality. So it's like that. But the Holy Spirit can postpone the winter as long as we need it postponed, but it's still potentially there. It is, has to be a potential there, because we're still in our pretending. So there has to be a build up tear down in order to pretend. So that has to be there as a potential. But it's just, you know, trillions of years in the future, it'll eventually tilt into this bad weather. Okay, like that. But it doesn't take long when you're experiencing a simulation of perfectioning to feel like, hey, I could live this way forever. I think California must have been somewhat helpful with that. Just living in just a place that seems like ideal. It's just like you got to pinch yourself every day. I said, don't pinch. I don't want to pinch myself because I might think wake up from dreaming. But it's just ridiculously pleasant, you might say. And up until recently, ridiculously safe, wonderfully safe, wonderfully pleasant. And you just, you know, you get used to it. You get used to it. And you just think, like, it should be like this always. My life should just be incredibly pleasant and wonderful, always. But the Holy Spirit takes it way further than that. It gives us this psychological feeling that, like, we're dwelling in a almost formless world, okay? And where everything is, the weather is so perfect that there's not even any form to it. It's just a spaciousness, that the form of the weather is a spaciousness. And the spaciousness is going to remain with, you know, as this terrific spaciousness for trillions of years until then it some point tilts into more condensed form, which then produces friction. It starts producing friction and suffering. Friction is suffering, you might say. Whereas right now, it's just so spacious that there's just no frictioning. There's no frictioning. It feels perfect. But the potential for suffering is still ultimately there. So I'm working on dialing this in. So that we have this perspective before these, you know, so someone's just hell-bent on messing everything up, right? Right now, they're trying to push the right buttons to mess everything up. There's no question about it. These people just seem hell-bent on doing what's going to trigger all sorts of friction. Massive friction, you might call it. And again, we're trying to convey to the Prime Creator. Prime Creator, we understand that you're addicted to perfection because you've been experiencing it for so long. But we're telling you, eventually, it all falls apart on you and turns into this massive friction. So you better get used to that. You better get used to it. Get your head out of the sand. Stop pretending that it'll always be perfect. It won't. You know, we're trying to convey that to the Prime Creator. So without abandoning our scheming, we stretch out the time scale of the frictioning scale, such that the frictioning is, you know, there's a huge storm over there, just the most worst frictioning storm ever, but it's a trillions of years removed, spacious wise. It's heading toward us, but it'll take a trillion years to get to us. There's this massive storm headed towards us of frictioning, but it'll take a trillion years to get to us. So right now everything's just idyllic, you know, totally idyllic, no frictioning. And yet we have to allow for frictioning within any dreaming, actually, because we're denying reality, and the denial of reality can only take a form, a dualistic form of build up and tear down. It has to be related to reality. It can't be just separate from reality at all. It's not possible. So it has to be saying, well, we're trying to enlighten the prime creator. You see, so and so in order to do that, we've got to, we have to posit a change in reality. Well, change to perfection means imperfection. There's nothing else the way it could be. So scheming, when we're pretending or dreaming, there it has to be a dream of imperfection, but it also has to be a build up, tear down sort of thing to try to convince the prime creator that, you know, how it works. So we will have the good and the bad. It's inherently dualistic. Anytime if we choose to try to get rid of the prime creator, it will have a dualistic dreaming or pretending scheme of build up and tear down, which is exactly what we have. And we're saying the good is backloaded with the bad, but we can change the space time scale of that backloading however which way we want to. Okay, but we can't be without the backloading. So Holy Spirit says, okay, well, I'm just going to backload it, but a trillion years in the future or something. So you can have just a totally idyllic right now. There's this psychological feeling of zero frictioning. Wow. And so this is just not being emphasized right now anywhere. I can't find it. I can't find even remotely. No one's even remotely close to this, talking about this. So I just have to stop paying attention. What are other people saying? They're just stuck in reverse. You know, it's just incredible. No, they're not able to look at it in this way. I've been big time by these great spiritual coaches who've tutored me, and I've just paid attention and listened and trying to, you know, say, okay, you know, there's got to be some way that they managed to do this. You know, how did they do this? I can see they've done it, but, you know, there has to be some way they did, obviously. And so now I'm seeing that, oh, it could be like this. It really could be like this. Wow, for all of us, so easy, right? Any one of us could avail ourselves of this at any moment, totally, because we're not getting rid of pretending at all. We're just all changing the scale of the backloading. When is the backloading going to hit us? When's the bad stuff going to hit the good stuff? When's the teardown going to happen? Well, the teardown's going to happen in a couple trillion years. Meanwhile, everything's just idyllic. Oh, I say, okay, that's fine. As long as we have the teardown still there, there's no panic. We're not going to panic. We'll say, okay, I like it. Let's then get used to the idyllicness of it right now and not be struggling like, well, how do I enlighten the prime creator? It says, well, you know, we'll that'll happen a couple trillion years from now. We'll work on that. Our plan. We'll spring that, you know, destruction a couple trillion years from now. It's like we haven't given up on it. It's just we've changed this time scale of when it's going to happen. And then that we don't panic. So we don't want to say we've given up on it. That's too scary for us right now, especially because we need the remedy, you know, ASAP in this world, because you got these maniacs doing everything they can to give every possible excuse to trigger a huge teardown. They want to spend another $1 trillion, basically. That's just going to, you know, kill the middle class. The taxes already, I can't even pay taxes. They're just, you know, crushing. Who can save enough money to pay the taxes that they're asking for? It's crazy. So they're trying to destroy the middle class. They're going to destroy the middle class if we're not graced properly. That's their goal. That's their goal. They don't want a middle class. Middle class doesn't like bureaucracy, doesn't like autocracy. Middle class says, look, We're pretty sharp ourselves, and we can figure stuff out too. You don't need to bully us and tell us what to do. They don't want that at all. They want upper class and a lower class. They want the technocrats and the slaves. That's it. And so the middle class is standing in their way. And so they're just you know, basically inflation is a tax upon the middle class. It's an extreme tax on the middle class. They give all these tax credits and assistance to lower income people, the slave class. They're supporting them like crazy. The migrants come over and say, here, here's your health insurance, housing, food, everything you want. Come on. We'll send you wherever you want to go. Make sure everything's, you know, the kind of sign up. We'll make sure. They love that. They want a slave class. But middle class, they just say, let's tax them more. Let's tax them more. Just tax them out of existence. And again, inflation's a tax on the middle class. And so, you know, they say that inflation reduction bill. Yeah, let's spend another trillion. That's really going to reduce inflation. No, it's going to be crushing for the middle class. It's going to basically say, let's crush them. We're ready to crush them now. Yeah, well, hey, pray for Kristen Sinema, senator from Arizona, that she blocks this bill. She's capable of doing it. She's capable of doing it. I don't know if she will or not, but I say, Kristen, you know, pray please block this bill. Vote against it and block it. She's the only thing standing in the way right now of this, of really just destruction of the middle class. Who knows what she will do? Who knows? But we send prayers for it, asking her to, you know, do the right thing and block this bill. Say no. It's not, it won't reduce inflation, it'll reduce the middle class. It should be called the middle class reduction bill. Because the middle class is already right on the cliff edge of destruction in the United States. And this bill will push it over the cliff. That's what they're intending to do, to push it over the cliff. And we don't have an answer. I ask everybody, I go, so what are we going to do? And nobody has a clue. They say, it's like, you know, what are we going to do? They're you know, panicking. What are we going to do? Can't keep up with the cost of stuff. So, it's madness. So, you know, we have to turn to the Holy Spirit. And Holy Spirit, if we're willing to accept idyllic conditions, for psychological conditions, then that will include, you know, whatever we need in this world, so to speak. No reason to exclude it. We're just saying, okay, we'll allow our misery to be backloaded, super backloaded, a long, long, long time from now, so to speak. We're going to experience just total idyllicness now, realizing that that will then increase our confidence that we can function in perfection to such an extent. We'll say, we don't even need this temporary idyllicness. We don't need temporary idyllicness. We're going to take permanent idyllicness. It's like that. But it's getting tougher and tougher for politicians to do the right thing because they're being threatened. Their family, they're being threatened. Their families being threatened. Their friends are being threatened. You don't know what kind of threats they're getting. They're getting extreme threats. And the senator may just, you know, said like, well, I gotta save my life and vote yes for this sort of thing. This is what's going on. So this is what's happening. In the United States is politicians are literally, and the Justice Department doesn't do anything about it. They just say, oh, that's great, good. You know, that's what we want. You know, they don't lift a finger. They're too busy persecuting, actually. They don't prosecute anymore. They persecute. They persecute the build-up people and sustaining people. I mean, Trimurti in India is a build-up, sustain, tear-down. They realize that this, the universe is a build-up, sustain, tear-down situation. So there are those who build civilizations up, there are those who sustain them, and then there are those who tear them down. So right now, we're in a tear-down phase where they're trying to get rid of the ones who sustain civilization well, like it's the middle class. They're very good at sustaining it. They want to get rid of that. It's Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva, I think. Brahma builds it up, Vishnu sustains it, and Shiva tears it all down. I think it's something like that, yeah. Shiva's the destroyer thing, tear it all down. Start another cycle, you know, just say it's endless cycles. Well, yeah, until you get wise and bring the Holy Spirit into the picture, and then it's a whole different ball game, isn't it? It's a whole different ball game. It's like getting Juan Soto, you know, in the middle of the season. Hello, San Diego Padres. It's just like, you know, what? Trading for him. Holy cow. That's tips the balance of power, I would say. It's just like, wow. He's like a super phenom, 23 years old, super phenom. Like just Ted Williams type of phenom, sort of, you know, and Mike Trout, like, and the Padres just traded for him. Are you kidding me? Crazy. That's okay. That's good. Good times. Maybe become a Padres fan right now, you know? California team. Come on. Who can hate the Padres? San Diego. Everybody loves San Diego. Very idyllic place, actually, San Diego. Super idyllic place. Wouldn't mind living there, actually. Yeah, that's for sure. That is for sure. I visited once. I just drove through. Didn't stay there or anything, but I used to hang out in Santa Barbara, which is really idyllic also. So I've lived in the South Bay area here, of San Francisco, South Bay area, which is idyllic. Lived in Hawaii, which is idyllic. Lived in Santa Barbara, near Santa Barbara for a short time, idyllic. And then, you know, visit the Coachella Valley and visit San Diego once just to see what it's like. And actually, you know, I would like to have stayed there for a while, just, you know, but it's supposed to be quite nice, San Diego. Yeah, although it may, you know, who knows? But there's nice neighborhoods there. Let's go to San Diego. Why not? Why not? Swing over to Coachella Valley, play some golf. Come back and get used to idyllicness here. Get used to it. People say, well, you're gonna have to pay the price eventually. I said, yeah, in a trillion years from now, the Holy Spirit has that waiting for me. The Holy Spirit will keep our suffering for us. So that's what it does. It says, I'll keep your suffering and tear down and tragedy for you there, but it's a trillion years in, you know, in the future. But it's I'll make sure that it's still there for you. When you if you want it, it'll still be there. But in the meantime, get used to idyllicness. And you may decide, you know what? I could decide just for permanent idyllicness, which is already the case in reality. And so then I don't need this temporary idyllicness nor the backloaded destruction. I don't need either one of those. That's a duality, two sides of one coin. Don't need that at all. You see how this works? As we're dialing this in. Or go somewhere where there's some water. That might be nice too, you know. So you know, lakes, rivers, streams, rain, green lushness, foliage, you know, just like Costa Rica or something. But then they got all these bugs down there, right? I don't know. Anyway, we'll accept something like totally idyllic. Totally idyllic. Why not? Gets a little toasty in the desert during the 4 summer months. The rest of the time, it's super nice in the desert. Super, super nice there. Holy cow! Just like you just walk around, and you just say, "Wow, this is so idyllic." I'm used to that. Very used to that. Just you know, having every day is just like super idyllic. But in the back of my mind, I say, yeah, but it won't last. It won't last. It won't last. That's the fear we always have. It's not going to last. But if it was like a trillion years in the future, you know, you might get a different experiencing of it. You might say, hey, you know, like that. Because we're paranoid to be without it, potentially without it. We say, I got to have it, you know, on call in case I need it. But, you know, let's just put it vastly in the distance, so to speak, where we can't feel any friction at all. The bird is still drinking. It's been the whole time we've been taping that hummingbird's been just guzzling sugar water. How you doing, buddy? Hey. Hello. Hey, yeah. Just guzzling. I wonder what happens to them when they drink that much sugar water. Maybe they get addicted to it, right? Or maybe it's like that. It's like this idyllicness is like this huge feeding station for hummingbirds. It's got so much sugar water in it. We can drink sugar water all day long for a trillion years and it won't run out. But eventually it's going to run out. Okay. But before we reach that point, we'll say, you know what? I've been drinking sugar water for like, you know, a couple hundred million years, and so no problem in deciding I'm just going to drink it. I'll be willing to drink it permanently, forever, and then we don't need the temporariness of pretending at all. Don't need the temporariness. Keep in mind that this whole scheme is mere pretense on our part. So we certainly can backload it differently. We can't choose the parameters. It has to be a build up, tear down situation. We can't change that. It has to be that way. But we can change the time space parameters of it. I really believe that we're perfectly within our rights to do that. And the Holy Spirit is custom designed to do just that. We just have to agree to it. Say, Holy Spirit, change the time space parameters. So I'm hanging out at this place of business today, talking with the guys, and someone had been hurt. They hurt their thumb, and they've been better. I'd say, you know, Buddha care prayers for them, petitions for them. And I said, how you doing? Back? He said, I'm back driving. And I said, oh, great. Nice to hear. Yeah. And I always say, if I find out about somebody, I say, hey, you know, just my, you know, may you get over whatever this is much, you know, how do I say it? May you get over this more quickly than expected. You know, may this go a lot better for you than you expect. Okay. So this guy came out, he just hurt his thumb. He thought he's broken his thumb. And he was just walking past. I said, what's going on? He's got something. He said, it's a problem. He says, yeah, I think I might have broken. I got to go to the doctor. I'll swollen up. I said, well, may you get over this, you know, much more. May this go much better than you expect for. Okay. May this go much better than you expect. All right. And he said, well, thank you. It really connected with him. I didn't say prayer for him, but I said it in a way that, you know, he could relate. Just may you get, you know, get past this, you know, a lot quicker than expected. So it already, you know, the pain's there, the suffering's there, but may you get over this a lot quicker than expected. Okay. I gotta pray for. I gotta petition another guy. Another guy's been out for 2 weeks. I said, "What's up with him? He's got a lot of issues." They say, "A lot of issues. This guy's got a lot of issues." So I need to make a petition. Just petitioning Papa Sama's Buddha Caring now. Just instant, direct, timeless support for so and so easing past paranoia. Wow, for easing past his paranoia, for so-and-so easing past his paranoia quick, you know, faster than expected. Wow. For faster than expected easing past paranoia in wow. Because all sickness is paranoia based. It's all paranoia based. We're too afraid to let go of pretending. So may all everyone's trouble, may we get past it sooner than expected. May we ease past our paranoia sooner than expected. This is how I petition Pamasamba's Buddha Caring Wow. So I've been getting a lot of views. I asked for an uptick in views. Now I'm getting them, you know, 50, maybe around 50 views, 50, 60 views per video. Even the time is okay, average of 15 minutes, which is pretty good for that many views. And the regular viewers are still watching, you know, up to 30 minutes, 45 minutes average. And some are watching the whole thing, which is great. Super helpful, as you realize that the whole videos have insights as we go along. Things get clearer and clearer and clearer. So it's very helpful to listen to the whole video. And, you know, I was just super tired today. Last night I was just so tired. I went to a place, Santana Row, and there's all these people there, all over the world, tourists, and just so demoralizing to see how absolutely the animal physicality of everybody is just like reeking of it. I just like, God, it was so horrible. I got really discouraged and tired from that. And so I was just having trouble functioning today. I was feeling extremely exhausted. Had fell asleep a nap when I got home, and said, how am I going to tape? You know, how am I going to even dial this in at all? I don't even know. I just have to trust in the Holy Spirit, because I just didn't feel like capable of doing it. But I said, there's so many people watching now that I can't just say no. You know, I got to do it. So I just did it, doing the best I can do here, and it turned out really well. May I'm really quite amazed. It's just the willingness to do your best. And then it just somehow, you know, I just don't like to fail, you know. So this has just been terrific video here. So we're at the 118 mark. Wow. Where there's a, you know, there's a will, there's a way, so to speak. It's just like, eating very well. That's for sure. Too well, you know, really. It's food in California is very good. They had all these avocados, 4 for $2.99, but they're overripe. But if you got them right now, make guacamole out of them. You know, you could do it. But it's going to go bad, the guacamole. The avocados are the toughest fruit to deal with. I don't eat them because when they're perfect, they're great. But rarely are they perfect is a problem. Waste a lot of money on avocados. If there was some way to stabilize them, but I don't know. But we have those all the time. Papayas, we got mangoes here, papayas, pineapples, strawberries, blueberries, bananas, fruits of all kind. They're just all over the grapes. The grapes are like incredibly good right now. Wow. Imported, of course, but what do I need to get? What's the next thing? Kefir. The kefir. What's this? Kefir is just very, very excellent. I can't see that. There you go. That's just, you know, when I feel like I'm hungry or something, I just drink some kefir. That's it. So, many little small snacks during the day. That's what I do. I don't have big meals, hardly ever. Just eat a little bit now, eat a little bit later, drink a couple drinks of kefir, and then go along with other stuff. Have some peanut butter. Have a little handful of nuts sometime during the day. I don't really think in terms of, you know, set meals, breakfast, lunch, dinner sort of thing. It's more just, say people ask, have you had dinner? I say, I don't know. I can't remember if I've had dinner or not. I ate something. I don't know what it was, but it was something. We had some cheese, Dijon mustard, and some lettuce, just a couple of slices of cheese, But really the focus is on singularity. It focuses on, you know, getting clear about this and experiencing it more and more and more. So food is just very much a very unimportant focus, really, at this point. Wow. Warm afternoon, but soft, cold breeze. Every day is the same. It's great. I love it. Other people want teardown. You know, they have to live in stormy areas. They have to live in areas where, you know, there's dramatic conflict taking friction in the atmosphere and all that stuff. And we're all attracted to that to some extent. I used to be kind of attracted to that to some extent. But more and more and more, you know, I can handle just like, you know, every day's just like incredibly idyllic. It doesn't seem to bother me. Whereas most people require catastrophes. You know, I used to look at like the Weather Channel. I mean, the weather and severe weather events around the world. I thought it's really interesting. And now I'm not really interested in that anymore. You know, if there's a big catastrophe in the world, I don't even pay attention to it. Don't even pay attention at all. And, you know, and people talking about fires going on. I don't even pay attention to fires anymore. What's the point? I'm just experiencing the idyllicness right now as much as I can. And I believe that's super helpful, super helpful. So sure, there's all sorts of wildfires. We're going to wildfire season. But this year, I actually just feel like I'm not even interested at all in wildfires. We're done with wildfires in California in terms of interest. We're so tired of wildfires. It just, and you know, eventually you just get so overloaded, you just say, forget it. Too stressful to even think about them. Just going to enjoy just the, you know, every day for what it is. And again, the water drought, you're not going to even, let's just enjoy right now as much as we can. And this will get us ready for something better, for something better. And we're like working on a house that we unveiled, took the fencing down. And the house is just like, you know, the best house that we've ever built. And it's just a stunner. It is just a stunner. Everybody that walks past kind of looks, stops or looks and just, you know, like that. And this is like in a super ritzy neighborhood. Everyone has, you know, very expensive houses and landscaping and everything, but this one is just so amazing that people just go, How you like it? Really nice. I really love it. They say, I really love it. Holy cow. It's just a jewel box stunner of a look to the neighborhood. It's just the best house in the neighborhood. Nothing's even close. And so you're hanging around for a couple years, working on this. And so we work on all these mansions. They're like the one before this couple was the best house I've ever seen. Now this one's probably even better. And then the other one we worked on is right there, incredible, like a paradise. And so you're around these houses. I'm just used to it. I'm used to just being, in gorgeous, mansion-like situations, but kind of modern and fresh, not these old world estates or something like this. This stuff is like all the newest materials, all the newest landscaping, the newest pools, and those beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. Because I'm working on them. Taking all the trash out of there, but I'm not complaining. I get to hang around at these places all day. See? And then drive around the South Bay all the time and just loving the idyllicness of the South Bay. So this has to be, helping me clue in this idea of idyllicness as the Holy Spirit can present this ideal idyllicness, totally ideal idyllicness, but we're understanding that the dynamic is that this does have to be backloaded, but it's so far in the distance that for sure we can continue the backloading as long as we want. So it's just like a win-win. There's no way we can lose in this way. There's no way we can lose. But we do realize we do have to take this final step. So we're preparing for it. We're preparing for it. And having already experienced reality, I know it's like a piece of cake. It's completely effortless functioning in reality. It's automatic. It requires no effort on our part to function in reality. Why? We just automatically just realize we're totally suited for it. We just love this total suitability. It's imagine if you had a guitar and it's like there's some music playing and you got this guitar and you realize, oh my God, I just know how to play this guitar perfectly. I can play any music at all. This guitar is totally, I'm totally suited for this kind of thing. And you just would then love any kind of music. Say, play the music, man. I'm ready to play. I can't wait. I want to hear. It's like you just feel you have complete talent in this, totally talented in functioning in reality. So if you're totally skillful, you just love the opportunity. You're not scared at all. It's like Tiger Woods in a golf course. He says, yeah, I love this golf course. I like this golf course. I just love it. I just love it. Yeah. Great birdie opportunity here. It is, eagle opportunity, ideal eagle opportunities. These I can reach these, man. It's such a beautiful course. I like the challenge. It was laid out great. I love this course, that kind of thing. And we're like, we're like saying like, I'm doomed. I'm doomed. It's like, oh my God, look at those bunkers, It's like, oh geez, the greens are so fast, the water. But yeah. No, he's saying, I just love it. Can't wait. I'll play 56 holes today, man. No problem. So we can't, you just love functioning in reality automatically. It's automatic when we think of old friends and